These varieties did very well, especially Nimkar 391, and got them substantial profits during the year of 1965 to 1968. Nimkar Seeds kept on exploring crops for seed production. They tried soya bean, but it didn't have a market at that time, so they gave it up. Recently, they found sunflower. They got hybrid seed from abroad, developed it here and marketed it in right pockets and got a huge success. So much so that in 2005, Nimkar Seeds donated a sum to Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute, Animal Husbandry Division, to build a new building for Livestock Research Center at Vadzal near Phaltan. Today, Nimkar Seeds produces seeds for 7 to 8 crops and sells it in 5 major states of India. My father, Zia Qureshi, looks after the business. Grandfather is always there if advice is needed. When anything settles down and starts getting into a routine, Grandfather loses his interest in it. Something new starts inviting him. He realized that rather than just improve hybrid varieties, if we produce our own varieties, it would be really worthwhile. They already had their own variety in cotton and he wanted to explore other crops.
So I decided to start register a trust again with my friend Nanavati's help. We registered a trust, the Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute. And by that time, I had become quite friendly with Dr. Swaminathan. Even now, I am great friends with Swaminathan. I only hold this against him that he doesn't give credit to the Rockefeller Foundation. And he's in the system. So I started the Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute, and Dr. Swaminathan came down to Phaltan and laid the foundation stone of our building at Thammar.
Dr. A.D. Karve, younger brother of my grandmother, Zai Nimkar, joined as the director of the Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute, NARI for short. He was one of the founder pillars of the institute, Grandfather says. He had many ideas and contributed a great deal to the institute until he wanted to do something on his own.
I had gone down to Georgia and there I found that a lot of people were growing jawar. I said, why are they growing so much jawar? Is it for, people don't eat jawarichi bhakri there, so why are you growing so much jawar? So they told me we convert the, I don't think many people know this, but jawar and sugarcane are related. And the jawar stalk also has sweet juice.
Here it was. The new crop was sweet sorghum. Now where to get the money for the research? He realized that a large fund of money was collected in India from the sale of American grain. Americans were using the money for various projects in India. One of the projects of United States Department of Agriculture was to help agricultural research in India. So Grandfather applied to the USDA to develop sweet sorghum. But things dragged. The project was not getting the green light. Nothing happened for 2 to 3 years.
Then I happened to go to Washington. When I went to Washington, I was surprised to find that I had mentioned earlier that I was in George School, that one of my roommates was a man by the name of Mr. Ed Brewster. And he came from a small town near Newtown, and he was the congressman in the US Congress from that town. And he had been elected. So I went to see Ed. I said, Ed, how are things going? Oh, he says, fine, what can I do for you? I said, I have submitted this project to USDA and nothing is moving. So what do I do? Oh, no problem. He picked up the phone, he called USDA and said, this is Congressman Ed Brewster speaking. What happened to the Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute project on sweet sorghum? Oh, it is here, but we are not. You are interested, sir. Next week, the US Embassy in Delhi got a telex. In those days, they didn't have email. Got a telex that the sweet sorghum project should be sanctioned. And so we got some research funds for working on sweet sorghum.
The research on sweet sorghum started. By that time, my Aunt Nandini, my mother's elder sister, had come back from States with a degree in agronomy. She and my uncle Anil Rajwanshi started working in Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute. Very few people know that the sorghum is related to sugarcane, and you can cross sugarcane with sweet sorghum to increase sugar content of the juice in the sweet sorghum.
So we made a sweet sorghum crop that the grain is edible, the stalk is edible, the leaves are edible, and you get the juice.
But the story was repeated. Nobody appreciated the crop. And now in 2007, people are working on the same crop and cultivating it successfully for alcohol and jaggery. He thought this crop could make a village self-sufficient. You can eat the grain, feed the leaves to the cattle, and get juice from stalk to make either syrup for feeding or alcohol for fuel. A complete answer.
Another big advantage what we did is we have converted sweet sorghum so it can be grown all year round. Originally it could only be grown in the kharif season. Now we can grow it in the rabi, and it grows very well even in the summer. It's very easy to grow. So a village can become self-sufficient in everything by growing sweet sorghum. Now in the beginning when we grew sweet sorghum in this new variety, nobody bought it here. But we exported sweet sorghum seed to Kenya, to Iran and to Italy, and they are growing our varieties in those three countries. Now in India, a boom is coming. Everyone is interested in sweet sorghum.
आणि आता आम्हाला इतकं त्याच्याबद्दल लोकांकडनं पत्र आणखीन विचारणा येते की आम्ही जे बी तयार करतो त्यातलं जवळजवळ काही उरतच नाही, सगळं खपून जातं.
And in Khatao, near Fulton, somebody has started an alcohol factory running on sweet sorghum, where he has got permission and he is making industrial alcohol.
Another crop Nari is working on is karadi or safflower. Grandfather realized that safflower does not require much rain and farmers grow it with jawar as a mixed crop. He felt that this is an important crop and needs serious research and development. Nimkar Agricultural Research Institute wrote a project to USDA and got funds for the research. After a few years, Mr. Swaminathan converted the project to All India Coordinated Karadi Project. Nandini Maushi realized that there is a big demand for karadi petals in Ayurvedic medicine, and a lot of pharmaceutical companies are willing to buy it. When he realized that karadi petals could give more income than the oil seed, he decided to develop a karadi with more petals. But there was a problem. Karadi is a thorny plant, so plucking petals is a difficult task.
So we found that we have one line in this big collection of karadi varieties which has no thorns. So now we have bred that for the petals. And the petals can give you 20 times the amount of money that you get from the oil seed.
Apart from his own business and research, grandfather kept on doing things for improving people's life. Bhade Lift Irrigation Scheme is one of them. When Veer Dam was completed, the government announced that people who lost their lands in the dam would be given permission to lift water for irrigation. Bhade was a typical dry zone village, poor, unemployed. People could hardly make ends meet. Mr. Dhaigude and Mr. Salunke from this village came to grandfather and asked him to help them develop a lift irrigation scheme for them. A new assignment. He got involved, did survey, brought engineers from Mumbai, drew the plan, got a loan from bank and stood guarantee personally for the scheme. He created a company, Neera Valley Agricultural Development Company. He asked people to give lands to the company to cultivate it to pay back the loan. People of Bhade agreed to it and gave the lands. Grandfather cultivated the land for the company, paid back the loan and returned the lands.
And for 3 lakhs of rupees, we brought 900 acres under irrigation at Bhade. So I said, this should be done. At that time, as I mentioned earlier, Sharad Pawar was just an MLA and he was in the government. So we formed a company, Neera Valley Agricultural Development Company, with Sharad Pawar as the chairman.
Some people did not trust grandfather, but didn't want to do anything on their own either. These were some villages around Bhade. They wanted the government to do a scheme for them. That was in 1972. Even today, there is no lift irrigation scheme in these villages and people work in Bhade as laborers. Another crop that grandfather worked on extensively was sugar beet. When he was traveling in America, he saw this crop and got interested. Later, he found out that in Himachal Pradesh, they grow this beet. Seed was available and he started doing research on his own. There was a problem of land, so he rented some land at the irrigation bungalow in Kolki near Phaltan. Mr. Yashwantrao Chavan, who was Finance Minister of India at that time, happened to be staying in the irrigation bungalow. He saw the crop and inquired about it. Grandfather explained the crop and its use.
The main advantages of sugar beet are two. One is it is a short season crop. It takes only 5 months. It requires less water than sugarcane, and it can be easily grown on small amounts of water. While in sugarcane, usually 18 months, at least 1 year, you have to keep the crop in the field. Then he said, who is the ICR helping you with sugar beet? I said, no, I have not applied to ICR and they are not helping me. So he asked me, is there a coordinated sugar beet program? I said, yes, sir, there is a coordinated sugar beet program being run by ICR. I heard nothing further from Yashwantrao Chavan. But about 4 days later, some officers of ICR came down and said that you are now included in the All India Sugar Beet Coordination Project and we will give you 1.5 lakhs per year to do research on sugar beet.
With that, he started the research from 1970 to 80. But as nobody was willing to take up growing the crop and sugar factories were reluctant to make sugar from the beet, they stopped the All India Coordinated Sugar Beet Program. Now after 20 years, people are realizing the importance of crop and they have begun to experiment with it. My grandfather was always one generation ahead of his time. Whatever he did, people didn't appreciate it at that time. But 20 years later, they took it up. Today, NARI is a full-fledged agricultural research institute. My aunt Nandini, as a president, runs the institute. The institute has also established itself in renewable energy. Anil Kaka started this work in 1981 and he is still actively involved in it. As time passed and things in regular irrigated agriculture became a routine practice, the usual thing happened. Grandfather got interested in dry land farming.
So I decided to do something dry. So I was looking for some place to do this and I met Babulal Gandhi, who was a Sarvodaya worker. He had worked in Bhutan with Vinoba Bhave and he had settled now finally in Vinsuni. And if you're looking for a dry area, really dry area is Vinsurni. So I decided to go to Vinsurni and do something on dry farming.
But working there was not as easy as it was thought. First, in Vinsurni it hardly rains. Second, there's very little soil and no good source of water for irrigation. He had heard about tree planting and afforestation, so he decided to plant trees.
In my usual way, I got trees from all over the world. ICRAF is an international tree research institute in Kenya. From them, I got different trees. We planted trees I planted 3 acres of trees at Vinsundi.
But then came drought and stayed for next few years, so all trees died. Few survived, but there was no growth. Growing trees was not at all economical.
These hills have always had no tree cover. Well, how can you put tree cover on them now? In fact, today's paper, they have shown, newspaper, they have shown the police department have planted teak trees on a slope, in a hill somewhere. They will all die. There's no point in doing that.
The only thing that survives in less water and bad soil is grass. So he started growing grass in his dry land. Then naturally the question was, what to do with the grass?
In my brain I thought, sheep. So I happened to go to Manny's bookshop, and there was a book on tropical sheep written in 1986 by a lady called Ruth Gatenby. She had, for her PhD, written a book on tropical sheep. I brought it home and started reading it. Until the next morning I was reading that book. And in India, somehow sheep and goats have been neglected. And I found so much information in that book about sheep. I had been rearing sheep all my life at Razade without really paying much attention. We had sheep, they used to graze on the bunds. I started out with 100 sheep. In about 10 years, they became 300 sheep. Then I found there were too many sheep, so we culled them. But I never paid any attention to them at all. So I said, sheep are very important. We must do something for sheep. So I was shocked to find that in India, nothing had been done.
He wrote to Ruth Gatenby to help him to do something with the sheep here in India. But Ruth said she was too junior and all her study was based on library research she had done for her PhD. But she suggested the name of a professor, Gerald Wiener. Things moved faster then, and Mr. Wiener came here in November 1997. British Council sponsored his trip. They travelled all round India looking at sheep.
So we went around looking at sheep, and Gerald was a geneticist. And he said, I don't want to see animals. I don't know anything about animals. I look at the productivity of the sheep, the genetics of the sheep. What are the records? What your sheep? How much milk do they give? How much wool do they give? How much do they grow? How many lambs do they produce? Some data. None of these farms had any data on sheep. They just wanted to show a sheep. This is a good sheep. That is a bad sheep. But how do you say it is good? How do you know it is bad? No data. So he said, no. This is a terrible situation you have got in India. Nobody is doing anything with sheep. You start doing something.
Sharad Pawar is an old friend of grandfather's. Once, grandfather said to him, you are a politician from Baramati and Phaltan. There are a lot of shepherds in this area. You should do something for them. Sharad Pawar replied, what can I do for them? Grandfather said, I'll advise you to rear sheep. Pawar said, nobody listens to advices. I will do one thing. I'll form a commission, a sheep and goat commission. And you study the conditions and submit a report to the government. Grandfather became the chairman of the sheep and goat commission and started studying the conditions in Maharashtra.
And Sharad Pawar also told me that you also study goat. It should be sheep and goat. Somehow, Shedi Mendi, that is in Marathi, they are always put together. Even though a goat is entirely a different species than sheep, have different requirements, they are different animals. One is caprine, one is ovine. So, sheep and goat commission.
The results surprised him. Apart from sheep, goats are very important. Because sheep are just within the belt of Western Maharashtra. But goats are all over the state.
And I was shocked to learn that sheep are not so important. In Maharashtra, there are only 2 million sheep. There are 1 crore goats. Sheep are only in this belt of drought-prone area from Nasik down to Kolhapur. Other parts of Maharashtra, there are no sheep. Goats are all over Maharashtra. There's not a single village in Maharashtra that does not have goats. Then I found that goats also belong to the poor.
And that's where grandfather's interest comes in. He recalls what his father had said once.
My father felt that the greatest contribution I could make to India, because he wanted me to contribute something to India. He said, I worked hard, I earned enough money, there's no problem, you do something that will help the nation. His feeling was that the people of India depend too much on government. He said, in a democratic country, people should do things themselves and not depend on government.
By the time the report was done, Mr. Sharad Pawar was no more chief minister. Grandfather decided to do things by himself. One of the important findings of the study was that in India, sheep did not produce twins. He decided to develop one.
So where do you get genes for twinning, production of twins? It's a genetic character. Anything you want to fix permanently, it should be genetic. You can give an injection, they will produce twins. A lot of women today take, because of the family planning pills, they also produce more twins than they used to. Hormonal production of twins is no use. We must have genetic production. So Zai and I went to Cyprus, where there's a variety called Kios, which is a good variety which produces twins. I didn't get to Morocco. In Morocco, there's a good variety that produces twins. In the Caribbean, in Cuba, there's a good variety that produces twins. America, there's a variety that produces twins. Government of India would not allow me to bring in any of the sheep because they say you will introduce disease. These people who are great veterinarians in ICR, there is practically no disease that is not in India. So what am I going to bring in? But anyhow, they would not allow me to bring in any sheep.
While searching, he found out a lady named Helen Newton Turner from Edinburgh who had written 2 volumes on sheep genetics. In his regular habit, he wrote to her. And to his surprise, there was something more than what he expected.
So she said, well, the genes for twins came to Australia in 1774. They had records. And it came from India. I said, my goodness, came from India? Where? She said, a ship.